Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
Today, the Jalsa Salana, the annual convention of Bangladesh, begins. I am not due to address the concluding session of Bangladesh Jalsa this time around, and hence they expressed their wish for me to say some things to them during my Friday sermon itself. With the grace of Allah the Almighty, the Bangladesh Jamaat is a very sincere one. This is a country where Ahmadis have even given up their lives in sacrifice. Around 12 or 13 have been shaheed or martyred. They have and they continue to endure hardships. Yet despite this, their faith and conviction in Ahmadiyyat and in the true Islam remains very resolute with the grace of Allah. May Allah the Almighty continuously strengthen their faith. Similarly, the Jalsa Salana or the annual convention Sierra Leone has also started today. They were also worried by some weather-related issues and they also had some security concerns and they requested for prayers that their Jalsa is a blessed one in every respect. May Allah the Almighty also bless their Jalsa. We should always bear in mind that we need to constantly remember the spirit of the purpose for which these jalsas are held and we should strive to attain that purpose. This applies to whichever country the jalsas are held, whether in Bangladesh, Sierra Leone, or anywhere in Africa or elsewhere. And what is that purpose? It is that objective which the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has explained on different occasions with reference to the Jalsa. I hope that at the inauguration of the Jalsa Salana Bangladesh and Jalsa Salana Sierra Leone, the extracts of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, in this regard, were heard by all. All Ahmadis around the world should constantly keep these objectives in view, because these objectives are not limited to just 3 days. Rather, these are the entire life purpose of an Ahmadi Muslim, Thus, we should always keep these objectives before us. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, on whom be peace, has said that one of the objectives of the jalsa is to develop zuhud and taqwa. Now, these are not temporary, but rather are qualities that are meant to be adopted on a permanent basis. Then it is that by coming to the jalsa to attend, it should instill in one the true perception of the fear of Allah the Almighty, which is also an enduring trait that we should adopt. This is not a fear which frightens one just out of terror or being scared. Instead, this is the fear of upsetting the one that you love. Then, by attending the jalsa and experiencing the spiritual atmosphere of the jalsa, it should develop within the attendees gentleness and kindness for one another. It should increase mutual love for the sake of attaining Allah the Almighty's pleasure. It should develop such ties of brotherhood which becomes praiseworthy to the world, who come to see such examples as the true demonstration of the teachings of Islam. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has also made us realize that it is necessary for his followers to display humility and modesty and to completely uproot arrogance and conceit altogether. Wherever Ahmadis reside, they should achieve spiritual progress, and then they should go forth and spread Islam's true teachings to their fellow countrymen. If opposition exists, that opposition can never destroy our mission. We must always continue tabligh, the work of preaching, with wisdom everywhere, and this is our objective. Today, Islam is being defamed in all directions. In Muslim countries, Muslims themselves are thirsty after shedding the blood of other Muslims. And the actions of the Muslims are far removed from the teachings of Islam. In such a predicament, it is we, the Ahmadis, who have to inform the world of the beautiful teachings of Islam. The most important thing that is required to achieve this is to establish our relationship with Allah the Almighty. It is to pray to Him in prostration and to beg Him alone for help for our work to be infused with His blessings. Then we need to establish our practical examples in displaying good morals, so that the world comes to know that if they wish to observe the highest standards of worship according to Islam, then they can find that practiced amongst the Ahmadis. If they want to see the highest standards of fulfilling the dues of mankind and displaying good morals, then they can come to witness it in Ahmadis. Thus, these jalsas are not just held for 3 days to gather Ahmadis together to teach them about the religion. Rather, these jalsas are held so that Ahmadis can experience the spiritual atmosphere that is created in these 3 days, so that they can remove the rust and the corruption from their hearts. The Ahmadis living here may certainly have strong conviction in the doctrines of Ahmadiyyat. And as I have mentioned, this is why the Ahmadis of Bangladesh have even given up their lives. However, Allah the Almighty desires for each one of us to elevate our practical conduct to the loftiest standards in this, the era of the revival and rejuvenation of Islam.
اسلام کی کے اس نشت ثانیہ کے زمانے میں اپنی عملی حالتوں کی بھی
You should be regular in the prayers according to the ways taught by Allah the Almighty. You should strive to infuse the true spirit of the prayer within you. I have discoursed on this topic in great detail in my last two khutbas or Friday sermons. Fulfill the dues of Hukukul Ibad, the rights of others, utilizing all your capabilities and capacity. As was mentioned, one of the objectives of the Jalsa is to develop Zuhud and Taqwa. The Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, peace be upon him, expounds on the meaning of Taqwa at one place, and he says, Taqwa means to abstain from the smallest and finest paths of vice and immorality. Remember, however, that it is not piety when one merely claims that they are pious on the basis of not looting someone else's wealth and possessions, not usurping anyone's rights, not committing theft, not committing adultery, and not illicitly glancing at others. Such piety is laughable in the eyes of the knowledgeable or philosophers. This is not piety, but rather it is a joke. Because if he commits these vices such as robbery, he will be punished. Thus piety is not what is worthy in the eyes of the knowledgeable or philosophers. Rather true piety is to serve mankind and show absolute loyalty and sincerity in the way of Allah the Almighty, to the extent that one is prepared to even give up their life. This is why it is said here in the Holy Quran, meaning that Allah the Almighty is with those who refrain from evil, and along with it they also perform good deeds. The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, further states, remember that simply refraining from evil is no quality in itself, unless one practices good deeds with it. There will be many who have never committed adultery, never committed murder, theft, or robbery. But despite this, they have also not demonstrated any examples of sincerity and devotion in the way of Allah the Almighty. Although they have not committed any of these excesses and wrongdoings, yet they have also at the same time not displayed any example of devotion in the way of God the Almighty, which is praiseworthy. And nor have they rendered any kind of service to humanity, and thus they have performed no good deed. Therefore, it would be extremely ignorant of a person to count someone among the pious by presenting this as an argument, because these are simply transgressions, and refraining from them alone does not make one an awliyaullah, friend of Allah. The Promised Messiah states, it is the practice of Allah the Almighty that He punishes those in this very world who do wrong, commit theft, engage in treacherous acts, and accept bribes. They receive their punishment in this world. Such a person does not taste death until he has been punished, and this punished is generally meted out through some mean or the other. Remember, therefore, that such an act alone does not equate to piety. The Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, states, Taqwa is the lowermost standard and can be likened to the example of a plate which has been thoroughly cleaned so that exquisite and the best foods can be laid upon it. However, can it fill one's stomach if the plate is well cleaned but left without food being placed on it? Certainly not. Can the empty tray satiate one with food. That is, if an empty plate was placed before you, would that alone fill your stomach with food without having eaten anything from it? Absolutely not. Similarly, is in the case of taqwa. The Promised Messiah states, what is taqwa? Taqwa is to merely cleanse the vessel of the nafs-e-ammara, the self that incites to evil. The nafs-e-ammara is a state that consistently incites one towards evil, and wherein a person does not feel any kind of remorse after having committed a wrong. Thus, taqwa is to cleanse the vessel of nafs-e-ammara, and once this has been cleansed, and a person begins to refrain from committing evil, this is only the lowermost standard of taqwa. However, the food that is then placed in this plate is in fact the virtuous deeds which Allah the Almighty has taught us, and includes fulfilling the rights we owe to God and also to His creation. The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, virtuous deeds is the food that is placed inside the plate, which then strengthens one's faculties so that they reach a stage whereby virtuous deeds emanate from within them. We should strive in performing good deeds in order to strengthen the faculties which Allah the Almighty has endowed us with, as this will enable us to fulfill the rights of God the Almighty as well as the rights of man. The Promised Messiah continues, it is to reach a stage whereby virtuous acts emanate from within, and so that one can also attain the highest levels of nearness to Allah the Almighty. When both these aspects are enacted and one begins to adopt virtuous deeds, then subsequently the level of taqwa will increase, as well as the nearness to Allah the Almighty. Worship is extremely important for a true Muslim. What is prayer? What is worship? How should one worship and supplicate, and what should its condition be like? What are the methods that one should adopt in order to identify the reality and essence of prayer, and how can one attain the nearness of Allah the Almighty by employing these techniques? What role does the prayer play in this regard? Explaining this, the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, prayer is the elixir which turns a handful of dust into pure gold. Such is the effect that prayer should have, that it should be able to turn dust into gold. It is water which washes away inner impurities. But what should be the condition of this prayer? The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, with such prayer the soul melts. The prayer should emanate from within the heart and flows like water to fall prostrate on the threshold of the Holy One. It stands in the presence of God the Almighty, bows down and prostrates before Him. The prayer taught by Islam is only its reflection. In other words, when prayer emanates from the heart, then at times the soul is stood while in a state of anxiousness, and at times it bows, and sometimes it falls into prostration. These are the various stages the soul undergoes, and its physical manifestation is evident in the prayer which has been taught by Islam. The standing of the soul signifies that it shows readiness to suffer every hardship and to obey every command for the sake of God. The bowing down of the soul, that is to perform the ruku before God, means that by renouncing all other love and all other relationships, it turns to God and belongs to Him alone. There can be no stronger relationship of love than the love of God. And its prostration, its sajda, is that it falls on the threshold of God the Almighty, and forsaking all personal thoughts, loses the very identity of its existence. Nothing remains of one's own, and one becomes wholly devoted to God the Almighty. This is a type of prayer which connects one with God. If a person wishes to learn about the reality of prayer, then this is the kind of prayer which establishes communion with God the Almighty. People often say that they have observed plenty of prayers but have not been able to reach God. However, they first need to develop this condition in their prayers. The Promised Messiah says, "And this is the prayer that the Islamic Sharia has to some degree been depicted in the prescribed daily prayer, so that the physical prayer may inspire the spiritual prayer. Because God Almighty has fashioned man in such a way that the soul influences the body, and the body in turn affects the soul. When the soul is melancholy, the eyes shed tears. And when the soul is joyous, the face glows with happiness, and one even feels like laughing. Similarly, when the body is afflicted with pain or distress, the soul also partakes in this suffering. When a cool breeze enlivens the body, the soul feels it too. Thus, the object of the physical form of worship is that through mutual relationship between the body and soul, the soul may move towards the Holy One, that is God the Almighty, and engage in a spiritual standing and prostrating. The physical act of qiyam, standing, and ruku, bowing, should ultimately achieve a status whereby it becomes a spiritual qiyam and ruku, standing and bowing. Consequently, it is the soul that in actuality is performing the sajda and ruku, prostration and bowing, and the physical expressions of happiness and sorrow should also be reflected in the soul. At times a person laughs and sometimes he cries. In the same way, one should also reflect these emotions in his relationship with Allah the Almighty. The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, "Since man has to strive and struggle for progress, if one wishes to make progress, then one has to toil and struggle. As such, prayer too is a kind of striving." It is quite evident that when two objects are linked together and we pick up one of them, the other also moves. But mere physical standing, qiyam, and bowing, ruku, and prostrating, sajda, is of no use. If one is only performing the qiyam, the ruku, and the sajda, the standing and bowing and prostrating in the prayer, simply superficially, then that is of no use. Unless an effort is made so that the soul may also partake of these movements of qiyam, ruku, and sajda, however, this partaking depends upon true knowledge, which in turn depends upon divine grace. Further elaborating upon this, the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, "In order to attain the blessings from God the Almighty, it is important to prostrate before Him. One should seek from Him alone. When one receives true perception and knowledge from God the Almighty, only then can one observe the true prayer in its true essence. However, in order to achieve this, one must strive and toil constantly. Only when one strives and struggles can they attain the purpose of their creation." One attains true taqwa, righteousness and worship. As mentioned in an extract previously, when two things are fulfilled, the due rights of God the Almighty and the due rights owed to mankind. Only when one fulfills the due rights owed to fellow man can he or she attain true taqwa and true worship. Explaining this, the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, "The fact of the matter is that the most delicate and difficult stage is pertaining to fulfilling haqq al-ibad, the due rights owed to mankind. People offer their prayers, come to the mosque, and even pay their chanda, their financial contribution. However, on many occasions, there comes a time when fulfilling the rights owed to our fellow man becomes difficult." The Promised Messiah says, "In reality, the matter of fulfilling our obligations towards our fellow human beings is a truly delicate one, because one has to face it on a regular basis, and is faced with this trial constantly. one should tread very carefully in this regard. It is my belief that one should not show excessive harshness even to an enemy. Some people put all their effort towards their ruin and destruction. They endeavor to annihilate their enemies. Then, in this process, they disregard all the limits of lawful and unlawful acts. And in their attempt to discredit them, they invent false accusations. They backbite and they falsify in order to provoke others against them. Now do inform me that how many vices and evils are born out of these meager, trivial enmities? Then when these vices produce offshoots, that is, one vice leads on to another vice, just as a child is conceived, when these offshoots multiply, to what extent will it grow to? The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, I tell you truly, do not hold on to any personal enmity against anyone. Completely eliminate the habit of harboring malice and rancor. If God supports you and you become completely devoted to God, then He can make your enemies subservient to you. However, if you have cut off all connection with God the Almighty and have no relationship with Him, and you make disobedience to His commands your habit, then there will not be an enemy of yours bigger than God the Almighty. One can withstand the enmity of people. However, if God the Almighty becomes the enemy of someone, then even if the entire world comes to your aid, it will be futile. This is why you must adopt the way of the prophets. May peace be upon them all. It is God's wish that you hold no personal enmity or grudge against any of your enemies. Remember this clearly, that one is only blessed with honor and dignity when he harbors no personal enmity against anyone. Indeed, when it comes to upholding the honor of God the Almighty and His Prophet, then that is a separate matter altogether. That individual who disrespects and in fact harbors enmity against God the Almighty and the Prophet of God, you should consider them your enemy. At this point, there is a clarification that certainly consider them your enemy. However, considering them your enemy does not mean that you make false allegations against them or devise schemes to cause them harm needlessly. No, instead, you should distance yourself from them and leave the matter in the hands of God. If it is possible, you should pray for their reformation. If it is possible, then you should pray for them and their reformation, and you should not start up any new quarrel or dispute with them. These are the matters which relate to the purification of oneself. Then explaining the incident of Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, the promised Messiah says, Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, fought an opponent purely for the sake of Allah the Almighty. Ultimately, Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, felled the opponent and sat on his chest. As soon as he did this, the opponent spat in the face of Hazrat Ali, upon which he got up and released him immediately, and said, until now, I was fighting against you only for the sake of Allah the Almighty. But since you spat in my face, there is now a personal motivation for fighting you. Therefore, I do not wish to kill you due to any personal enmity of mine. From this incident, it is evident that Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, did not consider an individual who harbors a personal grudge as his enemy. The promised Messiah says, this is a habit and disposition that our followers should inculcate in themselves. If someone increases his enmity for another due to personal greed or to cause the other individual pain, then there is nothing that will invite the wrath of God more than this. Thus, one should not cause pain to anyone out of personal enmity. One should not hold grudges or harbor enmity against anyone for personal reasons. If you encounter someone who is an open enemy of God or His Prophet, then you should move away from him, and if it is possible, you should pray for their reformation. Additionally, you should reply to him in the correct manner. It should not be the case that just because he is an enemy, one should treat everything he does as incorrect and endeavor to combat on all fronts. This is also wrong. May God the Almighty enable us to understand the true essence of righteousness. And through His abundant grace and blessings, may He enable us to pray in a manner that would grant nearness to Him. May God the Almighty enable us to understand the subtleties of fulfilling the rites of creation. May our every action, be they worldly acts, be completed with the intention to gain the pleasure of Allah the Almighty, and should take precedence over all other things. May Allah the Almighty enable us to do so.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'uzu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر.